Thanks for coming. I'm so delighted to introduce Ankhi Mukherjee, who is Professor of English and World Literature and a Fellow of Wadham College at the University of Oxford. Ankhi's first book, Aesthetic Hysteria, The Great Neurosis in Victorian Melodrama and Contemporary Fiction, came out in 2007. And her second book, One is a Classic, Postcolonial Rewriting and Invention of the Canon, came out in 2014 and won the British Academy Rosemary Crochet. These are very difficult. Prize in English Literature in 2015. Professor Mukherjee's impressive list of publications in journals like PMLA, NLQ, Contemporary Literature, Paragraph, and Parallax only begin to speak to the range of her intellectual commitments and the fields of study that she engages, from postcolonial studies to Victorian studies to critical theory to psychoanalysis. In addition to having co-edited a concise companion to psychoanalysis, literature, and culture, she's at work at a collaborative volume called After Lacan, which she's editing for Cambridge University Press. A common thread through Professor Mukherjee's work is her careful and insistent attention to the texture of language and a remarkable faith in the political, aesthetic, and psychic possibilities of literature. For this and many other reasons, I'm so delighted that she can be here tonight to talk to us about her newest project, The Psychic Life of the Poor, A City Unseen in Mumbai, London, and New York, which examines the vexed relationships between psychoanalysis, race, and poverty in the context of global cities. Just help me welcome Professor Mukherjee.
Thank you so much, Wadham. It's such a delight to be here. Berkeley is stunning, and I've never been here, so I'm really very excited. I've got my quota of vitamin D for the year. I live in England. And I'm really sort of excited to be presenting this work. I've been thinking about it for many years, but I haven't started writing it. I've just got the research leave that will allow me to write this. So this is really a good time for me to be presenting these ideas. They're sort of tentative at this point. So, you know, my Indian mentality is that if you have to have brickbats on anything, you know, it's better to do it, better to get them now. So please be forthcoming with, you know, hopefully some bouquets as well, but brickbats and critiques and primarily questions. I'd be very, very keen to hear what you think about this. Okay, so I'll start. You can hear me from the back? It should be about 45 minutes. According to Jacqueline Rose, perhaps the best way to move forward in the new millennium is to think about the things of which we are ashamed. One of the most stigmatized life conditions in all societies is poverty. The poor are routinely shamed and shunned, treated as idle, vicious, of low worth. We are ashamed of our poor and ashamed of feeling that shame. My own millenarian moment had something to do with Danny Boyle's Slumdog Millionaire, which opened to noisy, popular, and critical acclaim in the West in 2008, although Indian commentators were quick to slam it as an idiot's guide to India and poverty porn. Based on a novel by a former Indian diplomat, Vikas Swaroop, the film maps the trajectory of Jamal Malik from the slums to the orderly, democratic world of a British call center, to the global playground of the game show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. The film opens with Jamal Malik in police custody, accused of cheating during his appearance on the game show and on the receiving end of enhanced police interrogations, which in India includes generous administrations of electric shock. The police inspector wants to know how a lowly tea boy or chaiwala from the slums could possibly know enough to reach the 20 million rupee final round. Under interrogation, Jamal shows the fragments of a damaged life, each of which holds an answer to the questions he faces on the hot seat. What is showed is also a sense of a life, so not simply chronology, but a wealth of investigative detail, with the narrative deftly arranging and retroactively conferring meaning to life incidents. I did not like this movie, but what I took away from it is the upward mobility narrative that linked what Virginia Woolf calls the lives of the obscure to the triumphant life of a single dominant figure. It is nothing short of an Oedipal movement from the semiotic cora of the slums, the mazes of corrugated tin rooftops, the feverish business of a dhobi cart, the dense traffic of smoggy streets, the sea of humanity that is an Indian railway station, to the reality of metropolitan arrival. "I'm at the center of the center," says Jamal's brother Salim as they gaze out from a skyscraper on the landscape of their former slum. The child Jamal is little more than a symptom of cultural pathology, the face of a faceless mass. It is only after he escapes the slums and overthrows his Oedipal brother / father that his individuation can begin. Speaking of the depersonalization of the colonized, Albert Memmi had observed that the subjugated race always bears the mark of the plural, as Slumdog Millionaire reinforces this colonial strategy. The colonized, Memmi had said, is never characterized in an individual manner. He is entitled only to drown in an anonymous collectivity. Valorizing processes of sovereignty and liberal democracy in the West, Freud himself had written in Civilization and Its Discontents that in an individual neurosis, we take as our starting point the contrast that distinguishes the patient from his environment, which is assumed to be normal. For a group, all of whose members are affected by one and the same disorder, no such background could exist. It would have to be found elsewhere. Freud is, of course, talking about other races, but you could apply this to the class apartheid of global cities or to poverty. And so statements like Freud's give rise to the nomological claim that the primitive or the socially abjected do not have an unconscious. They are the unconscious. So you may also remember that Freud's sort of notorious observation that the content of the unconscious may be compared with an aboriginal population of the mind. And Freud lovers like myself would kind of blue in the face, arguing that the emphasis here is not on the perceived non-development of aboriginal populations, but on the primary processes that are evolutionarily conserved in humans, but the racial slur remains. The preferred trajectory of psychoanalysis, the preferred trajectory of individuation, is from group to self, a selfhood that is based on the exclusion of the group. In a brilliant study of the colonial genealogy of psychoanalysis, Ranjana Khanna has outlined Freud's use of the evolutionary progressivist model to show how the anthropological object becomes the historical subject. Psychoanalysis, Khanna says, is a symptom and mechanism of that process, of the creation of the European sovereign subject. She calls it the calm violence of interpolation through which a social contract is formed that individualizes and individuates members of a group at the same time that it confers upon them group culture or civilization. And this is evident in the way Danny Boyle's Slumdog leaves the entropic, if also richly relational and transpersonal group, to become a social and psychological creature. The slums become a no place, atopic, and constitute the ontology of the historical being, who is now, via the call center, at the center of the center. So my third book project, The Psychic Life of the Poor, A City Unseen in Mumbai, London, and New York, is a critical and historical exploration of the relevance of psychoanalysis for the urban poor in post-colonial and global cities. The population I focus on is, to quote Rushdie from Satanic Verses, visible but unseen. The denied citizens, or Catherine Boone behind The Beautiful Forever is called slum dwellers, under citizens. So the denied citizens or under citizens of this unseen city are subjected to forms of slow violence, Rob Nixon's term, delayed destruction that occurs out of sight, the catastrophic effects of predatory state capitalism in the neoliberal era, rapacious multinationals and self-serving NGOs, the third world urban boom without a concomitant investment in third world infrastructure, to mention a few key factors. And the book addresses the resistance of psychoanalysis, whether it is clinical work or applied psychoanalytical research, to tackle the psychic life of the poor. In an influential article titled Poverty and Psychoanalysis, The Poverty of Psychoanalysis, Manasi Kumar points out that there is an abundance of metaphoric appropriations of poverty in psychoanalysis. poverty of ego, poverty of symptomatology, poverty of experience, the psychological poverty of groups, which, according to Freud, again, civilization and its discontents, explains their capacity for enmity and the narcissism of minor differences, the anxiety of poverty, which Freud promptly relates to castration anxiety, the psychological poverty of philosophy, voluntary poverty, and this last is Anna Freud's concept. So these unreflexive figurations, they distance the real thing, and they also imply that to be poor is to have an impoverished inner life. In Hiding from Humanity, Martha Nussbaum looks at different definitions, comparative and social aspects of poverty, and she touches on a key opportunity, or what she calls capability, that can counter it. I'll come back to the capability, I'll speak more on it. But just one definition that can set us off. Having the social basis of self-respect and non-humiliation, being able to be treated as a dignified being whose worth is equal to that of others. So how is this capability to be secured, and what role in securing it could psychoanalysis play alongside general policies in the area of social and economic entitlements? 2 months before the armistice, at the 5th International Congress of Psychoanalysis in Budapest, Freud famously declared, I've put it up on the screen there, he famously declared that the poor man should have just as much right to assistance for his mind as he now has to the life-saving help offered by surgery. You can read the kind of quote in its entirety there. Whereas his theory aimed to be a de facto science in these years, Freud's clinical practice embraced the social democratic ideology of post-World War I Vienna. Between 1918 and 1938, Freud's pronouncements helped create a dozen cooperative mental health clinics from Zagreb to London. So these were the free clinics. They were free literally and metaphorically, and as Elisabeth Danto says, they freed people of their destructive neuroses, and like the municipal schools and universities of Europe, they were free of charge. I just want you to quickly glance at this slide, I won't dwell on it, but this just goes to show that what the free clinic movement was doing was not just dispense psychotherapy to the poor, but it also had a very important aspect of gender. It had great attention to gender and sexuality. So it connected psychoanalysis with the overall network of public health care. These were centers of clinical research, of course, free outpatient clinics. Freud, being a bloody-minded thinker, you know, sort of really worked out the way in which this could be carried out. So there was a free, there was a voucher system where an authorized signer could reimburse a colleague who had donated time to treat a patient. The last 3 points are terribly important, you know, when it comes to the work I'm doing now, that the free clinics were sort of pioneers in engaging with the question of gender, sex, and sexuality. If you know the work of Reich, for instance, you know, this is what he was doing, you know, kind of taking bans and sort of dispensing sex education to impoverished populations. Sustaining social welfare services through toward gender equality by improving the sexual and reproductive lives of women, and then finally pioneering work in the field of child and adolescent development. The free clinic phenomenon was short-lived. In 1933, Freud's books were burned in Berlin. The Psychoanalytic Institute closed, and Max Eitingen, this kind of a wealthy fur trading family who financed most of the Vienna free clinics, fled to Palestine. Freud is known to have quipped to Jones that he was fortunate. After all, in the Middle Ages, they would have burned the author alongside the books. The movement ended when, on March 12, 1938, thousands of bayoneted German troops marched the Nazi flag into Vienna. Around the same time that free clinics were cropping up in Europe, psychoanalysis had a promising start in the 1920s in India. We are familiar with this space probably. So Girendra Shekhar Bose, a Calcutta-based physician who later obtained a doctorate in clinical psychology, was the father of Indian psychoanalysis. In fact, the Indian Psychoanalytic Society in Kolkata is housed in his former home. Bose read Freud in English translation and developed a depth psychology of his own that was culture-specific, often at variance from that of Freud's. The two entered into a correspondence with each other. For nearly two decades, between 1920 and 1937, they discussed theoretical notions and developed a strong, if also ambivalent, relationship. I'm not going to dwell on both. You can kind of look, glance at that quickly. I just wanted to kind of talk a little bit about Lumbini Park, which has extraordinary similarities with the free clinic model, though both had no way of knowing Freud's pronouncements on free clinics. He read most of the stuff in translation, and they arrived at a temporal lag. So it's terribly interesting to examine this social democratic moment in psychoanalysis across the world and in sort of non-adjacent societies such as the two I have just mentioned. So Lumbini Park, 1940, this was established by the Indian Psychoanalytic Society. It was a mental hospital and a teaching institution, and it did not receive state government aid till after the independence, so till the 1950s. So it organized the training of analysts and formulated the rules for such training. Medical degree was not essential to train as analysts, so again, lay counselors, such as what Freud had mandated for the free clinics. So both Lumbini Park and Indian Psychoanalytic Society, Calcutta, had outpatient clinics. They still do have outpatient clinics. It's still very cheap to get psychotherapy there. Lumbini Park didn't, the free clinic structure didn't last for very long. The Lumbini Park still sort of has a spectral life in Kolkata because of the Japanese bombing of the city of Kolkata, the onset of the Bengal famine. So these are also these factors that I put on the PowerPoint are also, of course, factors that contributed to the decline of psychoanalysis as a whole. But it was terribly regrettable that Lumbini Park, the only hospital in India to emerge from a psychoanalytical society, met with this sort of, you know, rapid decline. So by the mid-1950s, psychoanalysis has developed by both, and the first and second generations of Indian psychoanalysis had almost entirely lost its foothold in academic psychiatry. The psychoanalysis in India declined in the later years of colonial rule, and primarily because Indian intellectuals, they wished to maintain their distinctly Indian identity. And I've read some kind of, you know, crazy work, you know, along the lines of how the Bhagavad Gita is the first text of psychoanalysis, so kind of disavowing the sort of, you know, Central European provenance of psychoanalysis. So the predominantly Western paradigms of psychoanalysis were seen to be incommensurate for the maladies of the non-Western psyche. And after independence, a key factor contributing to the death of the discipline was poverty. So if you look at the five-year plans, you know, the acute economic crisis in society from extended colonial rule, war, partition, refugees, shortage of food supplies, etc., led to an increasing need for attending to these external realities, thereby diverting attention and funds from the teaching of psychoanalysis. But before I delve deeper into psychoanalysis in India, it is important for me to state for you the research questions animating my project. Despite the ongoing social work on the depredations of urban poverty in areas such as neonatal health and infant nutrition, domestic violence, housing, and human rights, the psychological toll of extreme disenfranchisement tends to be neglected by governments and NGOs alike. My work establishes a causal link between damning sociocultural perceptions of the mental capacity of poor populations and the lack of state-funded mental health care provision for them. Exposing the entrenched social, cultural, and political contexts of mental illness, it shows how the humanities can contribute to current debates on mental health care. I mean, the hope is that the project will break new ground in comparative theory, combining my literary critical skills with the history of medicine, anthropology, and urban geography. The book chapters, the titles are placeholders really, Mumbai, London, and New York, will each have two parts. The first will bring into dialogue cultural discourses on poverty and mental health, so photo archives, fiction and non-fiction, cinema, while the second part will outline reigning mental health paradigms in each world city, discussing the outreach of related services to impoverished populations. So here are my key research questions. The first has to do with the cost of psychoanalysis. The payment of a fee for treatment is traditionally seen to be crucial to the transference relation in psychoanalysis. The transference is at once an obstacle to the talking cure and a means of working through, that is, a way of cordoning off a tendency to repetition, to acting out, and running it through the transferential circuit. Through the payment of a fee, the libidinal economy of the psychoanalytic dyad is set in play, the analyst becoming, or the analysand becoming bonded to the analyst, affected but also invested in a kind of imaginative and financial speculation. The concept of free clinics, therefore, is not free of contradiction. The transference, as Foucault, one of psychoanalysis's most critical readers, has noted, is precisely what differentiates psychoanalysis from the ethnological sciences it draws from. While ethnology saw primitive peoples as being without history, psychoanalysis reads the history of the subject as being both held and withheld in the repetitions of the transference, which it interprets. So simply put, and this is something a graduate student at Duke said after I gave a talk from this project there, transference costs, and to have history one must pay. So the cost of psychoanalysis, I think, poses questions to the practice of free psychoanalysis, in whether it is in the West or the East. Then there are the more mundane questions. Is there an association between poverty and mental illness? Can a study of mental illness in poor populations contribute to a fuller understanding of urban poverty? Who cares for the mental health of the urban poor in extremely unequal societies? And finally, and this is kind of a terribly important question from where I'm situated as a sort of, you know, a scholar in the West, how cross-culturally applicable is psychoanalysis? Can it cope with race and cultural difference, disparate paradigms of individual and collective trauma, and individuation in extremis? Psychoanalysis is culturally specific, as we all know, traceable not to the beginning of time, but the end of the 19th century. Nicholas Rose argues that the interiority, that is, the stock in trade of psychological systems, is best understood as, and I'm quoting him here, a discontinuous surface, a kind of infolding of exteriority. So it is an inside formed by discourses outside. The human being is not an immutable entity, but, to quote Rose again, a latitude or longitude in which different sectors of different speeds intersect. However, Rose says he also values psychoanalysis, and he distinguishes psychoanalysis from other psi systems, as he calls them, for its refusal to celebrate the sovereignty of the autonomous and self-identified subject of self-realization. So the third question, how cross-culturally applicable is psychoanalysis, ends with another rhetorical question. Can the theoretical reserves of this non-veridical discourse be mobilized to articulate what Emily Apter, in a different context, calls a dispossessive collectivism? In this case, a therapeutic public sphere defined by non-proprietary models of language and belonging. To go back to India, psychoanalysis in India, the similarities between the Lumbini Park and Free Clinic, I'll quickly kind of go through this. So equal emphasis on scientific and humanitarian work. The founders aspired to build a teaching and research center. Again, voluntary fee structure. This is also very important for Freudian free clinics because, you know, Freud said free clinics are free, but also they should have a sliding fee structure. So if someone wanted to use a free clinic but could pay, they should pay. So voluntary fee structure. And another very interesting thing about the Lumbini Park model is that at a time when thousands of psychotics lived behind prison bars and the stigmatizing word lunacy persisted, in anachronistic enactments such as the Indian Lunacy Act, the Lumbini Park Hospital offered a systematic psychological as well as physical appraisal of each individual case, very much like their free clinics. So this is, again, I'm not going to dwell on this, but psychoanalysis in context, so in the context of psychiatry and psychotherapy, I'll just skip through some of the key points. A 2010 study by Mishra Girishwar, so the, I've got most of my data from journals like Psychology in India, but also from the MIT Poverty Action Lab, which looks at different ways in which poverty can be alleviated or combated. So this study claims that there are 3,500 psychiatrists in the country to its 600 clinical psychologists. About 70% of the psychiatrists work in the private sector. The number of psychoanalysts has dwindled to 31. They're scary statistics. So there are 4,000 psychiatrists in India, according to WHO in 2001, which represents a ratio of approximately one psychiatrist for 250,000 people. In rural areas, the ratio is one psychiatrist for 1 million people. Again, the central budget allocation for mental health in a country where 10 crore people suffer from mental illness, with about 1 crore needing urgent hospitalization, is ₹103 crores, which is less than 1% of the total health expenditure. Tapush Roy, the founder of a Kolkata-based NGO, calculates that we have a budget of ₹13 per mentally ill patient per year, when at least ₹500 per patient per month is required to provide basic medicines. So, doom and gloom, 25,000 psychiatric beds are one bed for 40,000 people. 80% of psychiatric beds are in public mental health, public mental hospitals, where the quality of care, I dare you to Google Pavlov Hospital, Kolkata, to look at what a public sector mental health hospital looks like in Calcutta. It's absolutely frightening. I've been there and I must say I felt frightened to look at the conditions. So the quality of care has been found to violate the most basic human rights. Okay, just a quick, this is, and just to come, this is a crude categorization, but in case you're wondering, these are, the Calcutta analysts are usually Freudians, while the Bombay School is object relations, New Delhi psychoanalysts such as Sudhir Kakar and Ashish Nandi are Ericksonian. Having said that, last summer I worked with someone called Honey Oberoi, who is an English, an academic who teaches English at the Ambedkar University, and she runs Freudian free clinics at Ambedkar University. She also treats sort of Tibetan migrants, you know, using the free clinic model. So again, as I said, crude categorization. So just a few kind of, you know, details for you to note there while I change the page here. In what remains of my talk, I want to kind of look at, in the next 10 minutes, I want to look at two case studies. So the first will kind of give you some sense of why I think it's very important to have psychotherapeutic intervention in the plight of the poor. And the second records how such delivery may work. So in the summer of 2014, I worked with Pukar, a research collective and urban studies center in Mumbai, founded by Arjuna Padurai and run by Anita Patil Deshmukh, a Harvard-educated neonatologist. I emailed her outlining my project and her response was prompt. I'm afraid and ashamed to say that we have not come across any service delivery or psychotherapeutic interventions so far in the slums where we have worked. And then the voice trails off in ellipses and she says, and we have worked in a large number of slums. So while no one in Pukhar was working on mental health per se, I had a chance to discuss a study they had just completed called The Psychological Toll of Slum Living, an assessment of mental health, functional status, and adversity in an unregistered Mumbai slum. So that would be Kola London, that's the slum. We'll talk a little bit about it. So the researchers had used GHQ, which is the General Health Questionnaire 12. This is a screening tool used in India. They had used the WHO's Disability Assessment Schedule 2.0, serves as a cross-cultural measure of disability resulting from illness, cognitive disorders, and physical impairments. And they had also used the Slum Adversity Quantitative Index based on a sequential mixed methods design. And these were complemented by in-depth interviews of randomized people. The purpose of the study was to ascertain the prevalence of common mental disorders, these are called CMDs in the sort of sociological language, and to identify slum-related stressors that might increase the risk of mental illness. Survey data were collected by Pukhar's barefoot researchers, so local youth, many of whom lived in Kolabandal. They had been trained beforehand by a clinical psychologist and two physicians about CMDs, so the common mental disorders, about non-judgmental interviewing techniques, about research ethics, about the administration of quantitative survey, and interviews were conducted in Hindi, Marathi, and Tamil. According to the United Nations, a community qualifies as a slum if it meets at least one of the following criteria: overcrowding, poor structural quality of housing, insecure residential status, inadequate water access, inadequate sanitation access. The slum poor, as we know, are always peripheral to the existence of the city. The surplus population, utterly deprived of social goods or services, despite providing the labor critical to the functioning of the service sector in advanced and growing economies. And Mumbai has the largest slum population of any city in the world. More than half of the city's population lives in slums on less than 9% of its land area, making the slums some of the highest density settlements on earth. Kolabandar translates as roof dock. The name refers to roofs constructed in Gujarat and Mangalore and shipped to Mumbai's port area. So it's a slum of about 12,000 people located on a wharf on Mumbai's eastern waterfront. It's a jetty surrounded by water on three sides. The land is owned by the Bombay Port Trust, which bans its use for residential purposes. As a non-notified slum, Kolabandar is not entitled to any local governmental services such as municipal water, sanitation infrastructure, and electricity. And it is particularly vulnerable to slum adversities, chronic stressors, and traumatic events. 23.2% of individuals were seen to be high risk for having a CMD, and 73% as having some form of disability. So 25% of the 73% had severe disability. The qualitative findings substantiated and enriched the quantitative results by showing how specific adversities caused severe stress, which in turn precipitated adverse mental health outcomes. So to give an example, exposure to rats repeatedly emerged as a major chronic, if not traumatic, stressor, as seen in this women's focus group discussion. So woman one, rats eat everything, even wooden cupboards. Woman two, they eat matchboxes, money, everything. Woman three, when we are making rotis, they steal them from our noses. Woman four, on the bed we find leftover apples and other things they've eaten. Woman five, they eat our clothes. Woman one, they've even eaten our electrical wires in several places. You get the gist. So 51% of the population sampled testified to the adverse impact of rats in day-to-day life. Of this population, 33% showed a high risk for CMDs. That's a good 10% higher than the average risk of CMDs, which I mentioned was 23.2%. So needless to say, rats here are markers of structural deprivation. So household density, poor hygiene and sanitation, proximity to solid waste dumps, poor quality housing, and that it is one of the many factors in the complex interplay of stressors. The evaluation of disability, a structural feature of the study, provided the investigators with a unique insight into psychological distress, which seemed to contribute more to the overall burden of disability than specific physical deficits. The much higher WHO DAS scores, disability assessment scores, among individuals with CMDs, when compared to those without CMDs, highlighted the loss of function associated with mental illness in this social context. So the investigators responded with a resounding yes to the question, does living in a slum take a psychological toll? A study such as this really explains or confirms what it is really to secure mental health rights to someone. So the Pukhar report unequivocally recommends structural interventions addressing poverty and slum adversities, and they emphasize the need to explore community-based expansion of lay health worker-driven psychiatric interventions. So that's very much the free clinic model lay health worker-driven psychiatric interventions, training of counselors, and this sort of community-based expansion. So, as I said, this really confirms what it is to secure mental health rights, affirmative material support, as Martha Nussbaum and Amartya Sen's capabilities approach insists, institutional support, not simply ensuring the state's failure to impede. And traditional rights talk has ignored mental health issues, concerned as it is with the traditional distinction between a public sphere where the state regulates and a private sphere which it must leave alone. Our fundamental entitlements are not secured by prohibitions against interfering state actions. And the Bukhar report emphasizes that there's urgent need for affirmative action to determine, I'm quoting from Martha Nussbaum again, what obstacles there are to the full and effective empowerment of all citizens. And this is very important because, you know, when I talk to my economist friends who are working on poverty, they always say that, you know, but they need food, they need shelter, they need electricity, they don't need mental health care. But in order for the slum populations to have the ability to work, they also have to be mentally sound. As you can see, the disability scores indicated that many of the disabilities were psychosomatic. So I promised you a second case study, which I will, I have about 10 minutes left, right? This is kind of really how a free clinic works. And I shadowed three free clinics in Bangalore, and I just want to talk a little bit about it. So this is a free clinic called Samadhana, that's their Facebook page. So in Bangalore, where I spent a summer, again this was in 2014, my primary contact was Professor Vivek Benegal, head of psychiatry at NIMHANS, which is the National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences. And we discussed at length Benegal's pioneering work on addiction. Addiction is one of the key factors affecting mental illness in poor populations. And Benegal is sort of the really pioneering scholar, practitioner when it comes to addiction treatment. So he caps off addiction treatment, which is psychiatric, with psychoanalytically oriented psychotherapy. He believes that it's not the cure is not sustainable unless it ends in psychotherapy. He sent me to his friend C.R. Chandrasekhar's free clinic, the Sadhana Counseling Center in South Bangalore. The formidable Chandrasekhar, aka CRC, whom Benegal had described as the rock star of psychiatry, turned out to be a soft-spoken and unassuming man in his late 60s. He had the steely cheerfulness and can-doism of social reformers in India who not only initiate historical change, but find themselves in the unenviable position of single-handedly preserving its momentum. Chandrasekhar, who in his heyday is treated up to 50 patients a day, is deeply invested in two causes. The first is raising social awareness around mental health issues and furthering mental health education. The second is counteracting the commodification of mental illness in lucrative pharmacotherapy. Chandrasekhar, who was a psychiatrist at NIMHANS for 44 years, retiring in 2013, has tirelessly translated his vast medical experience in one of India's foremost public sector mental hospitals, and this is not a mental hospital like Pavlov, it's actually a fully functioning mental hospital, and that goes something, says something about the infrastructure in South India, which is really much better than the rest of India. So he does public lectures, public education initiatives, ambulatory care in villages, which is a very key element in the way the free clinics worked in Vienna. You literally got yourself a van and went to the populations who couldn't come to you. Ambulatory care in the villages, and finally, rehabilitation centers and free clinics, and they're called free clinics, that he set up with his private funds in the city. So he reaches out to 150 villages around Bangalore, to those people, he said, who did not have the 50 paisa, less than 1 cent, bus fare to the city. And he's published over 100 popular books on psychiatry, some of which have been translated from the original Kannada to Urdu, English, and Gujarati. He receives letters from patients in Karnataka and the adjoining states, describing various mental problems every day. So far, I have replied to more than 40,000 letters, he said. So it was his interest in Kannada literature that drove C.R. Chandrasekhar to psychotherapy. particularly the way in which human behavior was anatomized in the novels of Triveni and the books of Dr. R. Shivaram. However, mental health care, he says, is not only about delving into the conscious and subconscious minds. In a country like India, it is about addressing the psychiatric health of society as a whole. The Samadhana Counseling Center is run by lay counselors trained by CRC and a team of psychiatrists and psychologists over 25 to 50 sessions. It depends on your education. We primarily teach counselors how to be empathetic, Chandrasekhar says, showing me a diagram that outlines the basic tenets of counseling and thought bubbles arranged around the term empathy. Listening, understanding, being non-judgmental, being responsive, keeping confidences, and finally, this is in bold, making a change. The counselors are volunteers, mostly white-collar professionals with two or three languages. One of the counselors I interviewed, Gayatri Devi Prasad, has degrees in clinical psychology and education, and she volunteers once a week at the center. The counselors and psychotherapists do not follow any school of treatment as such, and methodology tends to be eclectic. It can best be described as supportive psychotherapy, a combination of psychodynamic, cognitive behavioral, and interpersonal conceptual models and techniques. With rural and poor populations, the task of the counselor often begins with removing ignorance and addressing misconceptions, superstitions, and unscientific belief in mental illness. Chandrasekhar recounts how on his visit to a darga where mentally ill patients were chained to a wall and in the throes of a violent spirit exorcism, he went up to the priest and said, "This is schizophrenia. Boss, send this man to Nimhan." So this is also what he does, you know, really trying to dispel ignorance about mental illness. Patients at the Samadhana Counseling Center start with an initial psychiatric evaluation. So you handed out a form such as that, carried out by CRC, and the pathological cases are instantly dispatched to hospitals, government hospitals, which have trained psychiatrists. The counselors decide over the course of the sessions whether the patient requires medicine, therapy, or both, and they devise pragmatic, workable, and time-driven sets of strategies. Through rapport building, we allow the patients to find their own resources, Gayatri Devi Prasad said. Unlike traditional psychoanalysis, the course of treatment is short, sometimes lasting for just 2 to 3 sessions, and outcome-oriented. The goal is the alleviation of symptoms, not necessarily helping the patients know themselves or their desires. The center is designed to look not so much like an analyst chamber, but a place of active commerce where messages are received, decoded, and recoded. Samadhana is programmed to receive people not likely to do one-on-one therapy. So the questionnaire that you're handed when you step into the portals of the counseling center is almost always filled by family and friends, and the counselors said they drew heavily on family background as well as relying on leads and feedback from family members. The most common forms of mental illness Samadhana counselors face, these were all poor populations, primarily poor populations, some suffering from acute poverty, others sort of low middle class, depression, anxiety, learning difficulties, neuroses related to family issues, and then alcohol addiction. The duration of each session is 30 minutes. Counselors try to understand the nature of the problem. Is it guilt? Is it loss? Is it anxiety? While also addressing immediate physical manifestations such as sleep deprivation, loss of appetite, low self-esteem. We don't go into childhood experiences because there is no time. The case records of Samadhana Counseling Center, as produced in CRC's many do-it-yourself counseling books, seem too good to be true. I just want to read out quickly before my concluding remarks. So there's 40-something Mrs. Pratibha, who has for 18 long years suffered from incontinence when under stress. The stressors seem at first to be money-related, so job loss, debt, the fear of financial ignominy. Though the problem first started at age 14, when she both enjoyed and feared a physical relationship with a male classmate. So the counselor in charge adopts 3 key strategies. She enjoins the patient to treat the urinary problem as psychosomatic, preparing her for treatment through therapy. Secondly, she removes it, removing guilt around adolescent sexuality, And third, she recommends practical common sense measures such as consuming less fluids before a journey. This is typical of Indian psychotherapy, that, you know, give sort of very obvious advice, like your mother would. Consuming less fluids before a journey, informing colleagues about the medical condition. The 5 counseling sessions are supplemented with a consultation with Chandrasekhar. We are told that he prescribed medicines to take for some time and instructed them, Pratibha and her husband, who has attended all the sessions, to come for weekly follow-up sessions to report on progress. 3 months after the 6th session, Pratibha is rid of the problem altogether. Now she comes to Samadhana once in 2-3 months just to recharge herself. She has stopped taking medicines and the problem has not recurred, the case record states. Now I've gone through about 100 case records at the Samadhana Counseling Center, and I could talk a little bit in the Q&A about other cases. But one of the things I noticed, trying to figure out some kind of methodology, I concluded that the cases lack transparency, especially in delineating the role played by pharmacotherapy or psychotherapy or both when the delivery of these was integrated in this free clinic. The interviews I conducted were not especially clarifying either. While Chandrasekhar had oversight when it came to counselors, his own medical practice was not documented in the case records that I read. The volunteer counselors say brightly that the center has a 100% success rate. The urge to reintegrate people with psychosocial disabilities back into societies is admirable, and this is what drives the free clinics, that you really have to get people back to work. But in the absence of follow-up exercises, this claim seems unsubstantiated. And finally, the methodology seemed ad hoc and too eclectic to set solid precedents. So C.R. Chandrasekhar is the engine room of Samadhana, and I found it difficult to imagine the centers running at all without or after him. But before I conclude, I don't want to end with this sort of harsh criticism. And the case records I read, most of which were on women, reminded me about the free clinic movement, because most of these women were struggling with problems that stemmed from sexuality. And this was another definition of free clinic. I would have to acknowledge that a free clinic was not simply a place which treats neuroses that stem from the wide gap between financial predicament and the prevailing standards of necessities that we associate with acute poverty. Free clinics, as Freud devised them, were also safe havens where women would, under the cover of anonymity and immune from social discrimination, be allowed to talk freely and be heard and acquire the capability, that Nussbaum word, to liberate themselves from destructive neuroses. So to conclude, it seems naive and futile to agitate for a more equitable geopolitical distribution of psychoanalysis when the discipline itself seems to have fallen into disuse and disrepute in India. It is, however, not naive and futile to urgently question the damning prejudice that the poor may not have intellectual or emotional resources to sustain deep analytic work, or the prejudice that the chronic poor need immediate relief and contributions, not psychotherapeutic assistance. The anthropologist Stefan X correctly points out that among practitioners of biomedicine, to speak of people as marginalized often amounts to saying that they do not have access to medical substances. Therefore, the best way to address marginality seems to be to give medicines to those deprived of them. The peculiar relationship, X says, between marginality and pharmaceuticals is especially poignant in the case of antidepressant drugs, as these drugs appear to bring the patient back to society, but not any society, to middle-class consumer society. So as X correctly points out in his work, and I love his article, Pharmaceutical Citizenship, the ideological project of demarginalization, as expounded by the WHO, the World Bank, NGOs, state agencies, international health and biomedicine at large, defines happiness in terms of consumerism, in this case, the consumption of pharmaceuticals. And as such, it subscribes to what Lawrence Kalkmeier calls the global monoculture of happiness, which also explains the worldwide spread of antidepressant medications. my advocacy of psychoanalysis is related to this distrust of pill peddling, this distrust of any purely pharmacological form of overcoming marginality. As Hani Oberoi-Vahali, whom I mentioned earlier, says, unlike psychiatry where the illness metaphor reigns, psychoanalysis can enable us to work with the patients, not just work on them. Psychoanalysis has not just a curative function, but an epistemological one. And interpretation involves the cultivation of complex temporalities and psychic depths. Girindra Shekhar Bose's indigenized term for it was introspective meditation. Yes, I'm arguing that we let in the not yet human other in the secular soul-making enterprise that is psychoanalysis, from its colonial roots down to the present day. As Butler points out in The Psychic Life of Power, the process of becoming subjective is indissociable from the process of becoming a reflexive subject, and that's the paradox of subjection. So the regulatory formation of the psyche is the very process that provides the subject's continuing condition of possibility, its dynamic psychic life. But that is not all this project is proposing. As subjects under capitalism, our identities, urges, and feelings are profoundly embedded in the structures of private ownership, of means of production, exploitation of labor, and the abjection of a permanent underclass. So I'm also asking that psychoanalysis, which has long attacked the false autonomy of identification, be repurposed to help expose this integrality of intimacy and economy, and the inseparability of the autobiography, or the myth of the auto-constitutive psyche, and the heterography of our socially constituted selves. Thank you.
So we have time for questions.
I was wondering if you could share your thoughts, or either your thoughts or some of the thoughts of the people who are working at the clinics in Bangalore, about Edward Bernays, the nephew of Sigmund Freud. In America, we euphemistically say that he invented public relations and marketing. And what I wanted to say is, did you come into any conclusions or any kind of thoughts about the weaponizing of psychology or psychological concepts on the societies that you were kind of focusing on? And if that was something that these clinics tried to address? I mean, everyone who doesn't know anything about India, like me, who goes to India, is aware of the media that you see, maybe because it's just a couple cultures removed from what you're familiar with. But you see like skin lightening creams, and you watch Bollywood movies in pretty humble movie theaters showing characters in the movies in big opulent houses. And there seems to be a discrepancy between the people who might be watching the films and the realities or the fictions as portrayed in either the advertisements or in the movies.
I think if by weaponizing you mean how does psychoanalysis become instrumental, so yes, I mean that's kind of...
I was really wondering if you could see people had effects of the marketplace on their daily life and their psychological well-being.
Absolutely. I mean, absolutely they do. You know, I mean, if you look at, the analysis of... So to go back to the work that I've done with the NGOs, one of the NGOs I work with in Dharavi, which is sort of one of the biggest slums in Asia, and it's a very, very big slum in Mumbai, it's actually an NGO on domestic violence. And, it doesn't treat mental illness at all. But 2 years ago when I first started working with them, I said, have you considered offering therapy to not just the battered woman, usually it's a woman who's being battered, but also the batterer, because otherwise this is not sustainable, because you stick the woman in a center, teach her knitting, and when the center gets filled up, you send her back to the abusive household. And this is really something that they have started doing, that they now bring in the family, not just the woman. And they try to discuss the ways in which, and they often feel that the people who are being violent, people who are raping their wives or raping other women, are terribly influenced by what they can see on their mobile phones, kind of the most violent forms of pornography. So to just address one of the things you said about the kind of consumer culture that seems to be, so I mean, everybody in India has a mobile phone, however poor they are, it's sort of cheaper to have a mobile phone. It's sometimes mobile phones are cheaper than books. So a lot of rape cases have kind of, you know, you found the rapists were actually, these are migrant workers who don't have access to their family, they have no women folk. I'm not justifying rape, but simply to answer your question about how consumerism affects some kinds of pathological behavior. That's definitely there. But you can see in the, to go back to, I don't know what weaponizing psychoanalysis means, but if you mean that, you know, how is psychoanalysis made instrumental, you see many of these NGOs actually using popular TV channels to, so in West Bengal, where I work with a human rights organization called Anjali, and they work on mental health rights, they use a very popular Tara TV channel called Bhalo Achi Bhalo Thako, which means I'm well, I want you to be well as well, to talk about the very basic symptoms that a lot of people don't know. So, you know, in India, you know, if you are showing pathological symptoms, sometimes in the villages they'll say your planetary alignment is wrong, or you are under the influence of Saturn, or, you know, you've been possessed by spirit. So they're simply, like, they detangle these symptoms and say, if you have these, we have a free clinic, or we have an outpatient clinic, come here. So this is a Calcutta-based program that's reaching out to villages who, again, a lot of village households have TVs where they consume these sort of, you know, soap operas, and one of the more popular channels which plays Bengali soap operas also has these mental health. So it, in a way, you know, the poison can be the cure. So that's my
thank you. First, thank you very much. I have a lot of questions, but let me just ask a few, and maybe we'll talk as well. So I'm struck by the psychoanalysis is part of the conceptual frame for you, and the conclusion also something like a moral frame. And it's but the therapy that you look at is ostensibly, as you put it, an eclectic counseling, presumably outpatient, that's not a good category, modality, which is not, in any strict sense, psychoanalysis. So at times they seem to collapse together, and so that the first question would be just if you could say a bit more about why you need, as a middle part, psychoanalysis. One could argue that, in fact, what is at stake in the therapeutic is not, in an important sense, psychoanalysis, and one still can have both, but that the distinction somehow disappears. And I don't mean to reduce the one, but it both means descriptively that it, but also analytically, there's something in the gap. The second would be that you depend to X on a binary of drugs and therapy. I'm not convinced of the binary. I'm not convinced of being part of X's argument, but it's also, which I know, but it seems to me that there are forms of intensities, absences, abandonments, violence across the presence and absence of both drugs, certain prescription patterns, and therapeutics. A lot of work, most recently Sarah Pinto's work on more inpatient women in mental health institutions in North India, but where the therapeutic, far from standing on some morally valued side against the drug, you know, so the opposition itself is I want to ask more about it.
So the first question is, I mean, that's my alibi is the traveling psychoanalysis, because, you know, I started out, as I said, I started out, one of the first things I read was Elizabeth Danto's book on free clinics. So I started out thinking, I just want to do something on the afterlife of the free clinic movement. It was such an enormous kind of, in a way, intervention. And there are free clinics. So, you know, in September, I'm going to be shadowing 4 Freudian free clinics in New York City, you know, which are run along the lines of the free clinics. Similarly, in the UK, there are free clinics. You know, one of the first free clinics became the Tavistock Centre, and, you know, there's a free clinic still attached to it. And I'm working with psychiatrists and psychoanalysts who run these sort of outpatient clinics. So psychoanalysis, therefore, is kind of almost the shorthand with which I can bring these different kinds of different forms of guerrilla volunteerism when it comes to mental health together. The question you asked is extremely important, you know, about psychoanalysis. So what I take away from this social democratic moment of psychoanalysis is not simply It's not just sort of a, not only is it a bourgeois commodity, it is also not sort of in the stranglehold of the highly educated. It is kind of very, what I take away from this moment of psychoanalysis is the transmission of psychoanalysis. So to go back to Anjali, the mental health organization where I worked, they actually have psychoanalysts coming to train the lay counselors, not psychiatrists, because a lay counselor cannot prescribe medicine. So that's kind of where psychoanalysis is useful, because they take the best things about the talk therapy, where you engage with that sort of a dyad. You know, you are allowing the patient's unconscious to speak to them through you. You know, and that's the psychoanalyst teaches the lay counselors. The lay counselors go into the municipal area. So I worked with an area called Rajarhat, which is filled with kind of very impoverished Muslims. So even a lay counselor from the municipality of Rajarhat, who's Hindu, can't go into the home where there is a woman who is. So their job, where there is a Muslim woman suffering from kind of some form of psychic malady, so the lay counselor then has a kiosk in Rajarhat, and they throw leaflets through the doors, and you know, say that if you have any problems, you can come to me. And they in turn train Muslim women who then have psychotherapy sessions on the terrace of a house. So that's the thing I thought was only possible through psychoanalysis, because what you are really teaching or transmitting was, again, you know, those kind of bullet points around empathy, that listening, not judging, trying to disambiguate, you know, people's ignorance about mental health, trying to also kind of, in a way, connecting, you know, of course, none of these people will advise you if you're saying that I'm suicidal, that's when they'll immediately prescribe you or send you to a doctor. So they know their limits, but it's really for kind of anxiety and stress and lack of sleep and lack of you know, functionality, that this is extremely useful. And psychoanalysis in this sort of translated mode, in this watered down mode, is something that can be part of this transferential circuit. Right? So that's why I think it is valuable. But you're absolutely right that in each of the cases, I'm very careful to kind of say this is not classical psychoanalysis, you know. And in a center like Chandrasekhar's, he knows, because he knows that people won't come back, you know, so they want quick outcomes. And the second question, I think, and that's a very valuable question, because most of the free clinics, you know, they have a reigning psychiatrist. So even Vivek Benegal's work, you know, it starts with medicines, you know, Pukar, which is run by Anita Patil Deshmukh, you know, the sister of the illustrious Smita Patil. She says that when she goes there and is trying to teach women about menstrual health, they say, can you not give me a pill instead? So you are not taken seriously if you don't, as a social worker, if you don't kind of dispense with pills. But what they're kind of saying is that giving pills, or, you know, that's simply not enough. You simply have to, for this cure to be long-lasting, you simply have to build in that element of sort of, you know, of therapy, of therapeutic care. Much of it in Nimhans involves getting the family to talk to you, or the rehabilitation of a victim sort of traumatized by rape. You know, that'll happen through kind of family therapy. And I was talking to a friend in South Africa, and they were saying this is becoming psychoanalysis moving towards sort of CBT and family therapy was so common there too. You know, in the sort of aftermath of apartheid.
Thanks. Yeah. This is really interesting. I've been thinking about some of this stuff from the British perspective and the current Pacific, especially when you just said about move towards CBT and the kind of like push for results of like the pint. So I can be at the end of Freud's essay of like analysis, temple on example, like how long does an analytic brain last? Do people who are impoverished have and I'm also thinking about this, I mean, this is kind of a cool question about the politics of what you're talking about, and I'm perhaps you can say something about how that would relate to the Indian situation. You said that the free clinics, you're bringing social democratic gestures. I think of them, particularly in terms of like Reich's version of the free clinic, as like aggressively communist.
Right.
And like a real deliberation towards the kind of like proletarian sexual gratification. And I guess the obvious critique of that is the endpoint of Freudian psychoanalysis, that he basically thinks that if you're sexually satisfied, then the revolution can come next week.
Right.
which is the question. But I wonder if you could say something about, like, the relationship between the social origins of unhappiness outside of the like individual and family unit, something you think of like David Smale's work, how that relates to like anti-psychiatry and the anthropological growth in your project, and then how that relates to things like policing of mental health. And so in the UK, the fact that the Mental Health Act leads to sectioning of people and women of colour more than does white men. Like there's a kind of like political tool used to attack minorities, basically. How that kind of like the political element to like state provision of mental health care, and how do you get to get them?
To go back to the question about UK, I mean, you know, this is a very new project, and I have only just finished my fieldwork in India. And I'm about to start on kind of, you know, my work in America. And so as I said, I'm shadowing 4 free clinics and also working with a tremendous sort of figure in clinical medicine. Her name is Jimmy Holland, and she's an oncologist at the Sloan Kettering Hospital who's become a psycho-oncologist. And that's another very exciting sort of, in a way, combination where you feel, and I've seen this in India as well, people say that when they come up against kind of, you know, the way cancer is treated, among other things, they're really very, very influenced. So one of the people I talked to, called Srinivasa Murthy, the father of psychiatry of the present generation, says that, you know, it's when he got cancer he realized he was the poorest of the poor, because the treatment was really only drugs. There was absolutely nothing by way of therapy or counseling. So Jimmy Holland, you know, who's a psycho-oncologist, calls himself a psycho-oncologist, says a very similar thing, that it was her treating of cancer that she realized that it was incredibly important to also offer kind of talk therapy. So I've not worked, but to go back to the UK example, one of the things we saw over our breakfast cereal 7 days ago is a case where somebody, a young man in his early 20s had suffered a psychotic episode, you know, which he hadn't had before. He hadn't been diagnosed with mental illness. Suffered a psychotic episode, breaks off a bottle and sticks it into his father's kind of, you know, body, like into his father's stomach. And the father says that, "I didn't take it out, I was holding it. I didn't want to take it out because I knew that he would stick it in his neck next." So this happened 3 years ago. Guess what happened to the perpetrator, you know, who is, as I said, suffering a psychotic episode. Instead of being sent to a psychiatric institution, he's imprisoned. This is happening in modern day London, and he's imprisoned, and that's where he takes his life. So, you know, I mean, it was just one of these heartbreaking episodes of this filial love, where the father was willing to die because he didn't want his son to kill himself. He was letting a sort of a broken bottle remain lodged in his body till help arrived. And of course, the sort of paternalistic state sending this young man to a precipice of death, exactly overlooking. This is exactly why I think the psychiatric model does not work, because, you know, it is, India is of course an extreme example of this, but it is seen as a sort of form of punishment, you know, it is. And the post-treatment life does not exactly sort of, you know, help you reintegrate. You know, it does not help you reintegrate into society, you know, which was one of the things that the free clinic movement really wanted to do, that kind of, you know, bring you back to the workforce. You know, there's a really wonderful, I deleted that part. So Max Schur, who was the physician who helped Freud die, you know, his wife said that Freud wanted them to work well and love well, you know, something like that. That it was not just about, it's not this sort of drive of developing countries to kind of, you know, really convert everyone into a money-making machine, but also to love well, that, you know, they had to be rehabilitated into kind of a full citizenship, you know, full capability. And what the civic education or what you had failed in doing, you know, the free clinic phenomenon would provide. So you have this in the UK as well, that the maladies of the poor are very quickly medicalized. You know, the biomedicine it prevails, and I'm not at all against it. Psychoanalysis has nothing to do with psychosis. You know, it's inadequate for treating psychosis. You do need the sort of pharmaceuticals, but I think it would be very ill-advised to only kind of dispense with the pills and not provide the kind of
My point is just it's actually just that the binary is what I'm questioning, not the not any claim on one side or the other.
Well, the binary exists in a country like India in the sense that there are absolutely no psychotherapeutic care, whereas psychiatry is available, though these hospitals are terrible.
But as you point out, the giving of the pill is tied to a therapeutic sort of desire about the desire for a pill. So the pill becomes very much the ground of something like a therapeutics. So that is, I'm really interested in to what extent, I mean, I'm pushing, but it's literally, conceptually, in making a distinction between drugs as things, therapy is as a way outside.
No, absolutely.
It
I agree with you.
It's a lot of work, but
no, it's not about. But the only thing is that you know, when I gave this talk to a sort of history of medicine center, one of the students there asked me a question which is terribly important, and he said, "Do the people who go to these centers want psychoanalysis? Or you know, do they?" And that is a very important way in which this binary can be reinstated. So to go back to the domestic violence example. The woman wants to be freed from a husband who's beating the crap out of her, you know, but so she doesn't want psychoanalysis as such. But and so you know, in cases such as that, I think the psychiatric model doesn't work, you know, and that is really where you have to. So where you know they're not really showing pathological symptoms, but could do something with an understanding of the conditions that are plaguing them. Psychotherapy would work. So a lot of the thing, you know, so I shadowed Samadhana, you know, and a lot of the people who came to the center were villagers from around Bangalore, which is a fairly wealthy city in India, a very sort of westernized city. And one of the villagers said that he was debilitated because he kept dreaming of a red bull chasing him. Now, you know, as Pratibha says, that they have no time to delve into childhood. And they have to connect it with something that's happening. So what's happening in his life is kind of crop failures, lack of monsoons, etc. And it's very difficult to treat this with pills alone because you know this is not going to go away. It's not PTSD that he's suffering, but it's what South African psychoanalysts call CTSD, so continuing traumatic stress disorder. So because the bad crops, the failure of the agricultural sector, none of these are going to be in the past. So how do you make this person reconcile with, you know, their lot? So I think for stuff like that, the talk therapy might be useful, more useful.
Thank you very, very much for your talk. I have tons of questions, but I'm fascinated by the notion of the pathological of the city or the city as pathological. Mindy Foley Love's work out of Colombia, who does work on, she's a psychiatrist who treats cities. And really sees urban planning as a kind of solution to some of the problems that facing the radically poor. And and I want to read your work really perversely. I'm so sorry. Like I want to sort of scale back and look at early Freud and really look at the suffering urban poor as symptomatic of a kind of pathology. It's the place where the trauma in history voices itself, and it sort of takes it does read the urban poor as the unconscious of the nation in some sort of sense, and really says that there is something that people aren't listening to with respect to particularly things like addiction, and so like with the addict, it's famously untreatable in psychoanalysis. Like it's really difficult to think of what it would look like to treat them if not urban planning, if not, you know, radical reforms of you know, structural reforms that actually change material conditions. Because the problem is itself sort of a self-medication. I was just wondering your thoughts on addiction, your thoughts on sort of looking at the pathology of nation and what the problems might be in reading that into the Indian context.
I mean, you know, this is one of many ways of poverty alleviation, you know, and all I'm saying is this be counted. And in what in psychoanalysis appeals to me is it's, from the start, is it sort of, you know, fear of biological reductionism. You know, it's really, if you look at the history of psychoanalysis in America, for instance, most of the people who became psychoanalysts were actually neurologists. They were not psychiatrists. So it's kind of a, I find that terribly interesting, you know, and I don't remember who said this. I think it's some head of psychiatry in the US said that earlier the model used to be, you know, biopsychosocial, but now it's bio, you know. And so it's, all I'm saying is, it's not just the body that needs to be treated, but you need to treat the fact that suicide rates in slums are higher than, I don't have the statistic in hand, but they're higher than suicide rates in the rest of the city. I mean, keep in mind that the most impoverished people in a country like India today are not slum dwellers, but farmers. So, but the reason I've chosen cities is because I need to kind of be able to talk about this in the context of the psychiatric culture of the city in general. So where there is no psychiatry or psychoanalysis at all, you know, you can't really, I wouldn't know what to compare this to. But I'm talking about cities like Bombay where psychoanalysis survives, or, you know, the variants of psychoanalysis or psychotherapy are very much in vogue, where there is also no treatment for the poor. And you can't walk into a slum today without stumbling on 5 NGOs, but none of them are working on mental health. As I said, Anita Patti's statement was shocking to me, that she works in so many slums. You know, Pukhar is one of the biggest sort of urban research platforms. And, you know, she said that no one is working on mental illness, whereas a report that's come from Pukhar has all these wonderful insights about the psychological toll of slum living. And so that I think is my job, to kind of, you know, be looking at offcuts. That's where mental health is in India, you know, offcuts of your research. But to go back to your other question, of course infrastructure has to be addressed. And one of the first NGOs I worked with, URBZ, U-R-B-Z, they work with, you know, the way in which the slums can, you know, they don't have to be put in vertical housing, but horizontal housing, how they can move into dilapidated or rundown neighborhoods in Bombay instead of putting them in council estate type buildings, which are feared by the slum dwellers. But, you know, I mean, a lot of people who are working on infrastructure, I mean, if you go into a slum like Dharavi, there are parts of Dharavi which don't look like a slum at all. It's a huge slum, but parts of it look like a low middle class neighborhood. So slums are very uneven. You know, there are also sort of little pockets of wealth, as we know from cinema, you know, there's so many children of God, you know, that there are pockets of wealth, you know, obviously drug dealers and politicians. And Catherine Booth, you know, Behind the Beautiful Forevers is good in showing how most slum dwellers actually don't want to live in slums. You know, they're looking at ways in which they can actually move into another kind of horizontal housing, you know. So, yes, infrastructure is absolutely important, and there is work on that, you know. I'm simply sort of, you know, this is a supplement, and I think it's a supplement that will undo the work unless it's really seriously taken.
So I've got lots of questions. I'm really excited about this project. And one of the things I really love, and I'd love for you to talk a little bit about, is how a project on poverty is haunted by excess. And one being the very scene of psychoanalysis as one of excess. It's a luxury. When you think of the Freudian patient is the one who has the time, has the economic luxury, but also the analyst has the time, right? In traditional analytic training, you have years and years of your own analysis. You have the sort of time to develop the kind of intimacies, to develop transference and countertransference. So it becomes a site of excess, right? We think of the patient who's able to be neurotic or able to be hysterical. And here for the poor, right, the poor don't seem to have that luxury, and yet what you're pointing to is that that's a false binary, right? There's the poor don't have the luxury of psychoanalysis, they also have the luxury of madness, right? The poor have kind
exactly.
of basic life-giving needs. So I'm wondering just about how we might think about, in some ways to go back to Lawrence's question, I'm all about recovering psychoanalysis. So how do we recover psychoanalysis from its history of the kind of luxury and excess to think about why these models that you're pointing to, the talking cure, the kind of ability to identify something within yourself that isn't etiological, isn't CBT, right? But is it's a thing inside of you always that might give it a new purchase. I'm interested in whether or not we can bring psychoanalysis back from excess into poverty.
That's an extraordinary binary, and I hadn't thought about it, you know, in those terms. And, you know, one of the things, when I was when I first started at Oxford, one of my first encounters with celebrity was a talk that Julia Kristeva gave. And, you know, of course, I had read everything by her, and I asked her a terribly clever question. And she just, you know, kind of looked at me point blank, and she said that, that's a very clever question, Ankhi, but, you know, you're forgetting that I'm a practicing psychoanalyst and I'm in the business of curing pain. You know, so for me, psychoanalysis is pain and malady. And I do think that one of the ways in which psychoanalysis, what I almost became a Lacanian, I almost didn't finish my PhD and I thought I would train as an analyst. What put me off terribly was not just the sort of, you know, bourgeois commodification of psychoanalysis, but also how it had completely lost touch with this pain, which was the cornerstone of psychoanalysis. And I do think that that trying to decode and recode pain is one way in which you can translate this in a context like India. And that's what they are doing. So Hani Oberoi, she has a wonderful book on Tibetan migrants, who is one of the biggest demographics that she looks at. You know, and it's an extraordinary way in which the pain of migrancy is, and you know, these internal immigrants in India, you know, what the status of these internal immigrants is teaching her to kind of in a way reevaluate kind of long-held ideas about displacement, you know, in this Freudian sense, melancholy and mourning, you know. So I think you're absolutely right that the temporality of the psychoanalytic session, the technique of the psychoanalytic session, these will be put under pressure in countries like India. But if we go back to the cornerstone, which is sort of pain and malady, and somehow they don't go away, you simply have a better understanding of them, you have better self-knowledge, you understand your symptom, you enjoy your symptom, not too much. That can be done through kind of in a way devising, and some of the methods are ad hoc. As I was critical of the methods that, you know, Chandrasekhar is using, some of them are ad hoc, but they are better than nothing. They're better than sort of, you know, applying electric shock, which still happens in a hospital like Pavlov in India.
Why is that bad?
What's that?
Why is that bad?
Electric shock.
It's a long conversation, but it's speaking of bourgeois ideas. No, I mean it's demanded by many people because of its temporality. Against European ideas of this.
Well, the thing is that most people who receive electric shock in these public sector mental hospitals are people who have been abandoned by their family. So it is just to sort of, in a way, in India, it is done to sort of, in a way, render them docile, servile, almost speechless, kind of, you know, automatons. So there is no agency there at all. What you're saying is, I think, a different. I mean, I don't know. I haven't.
Yeah, there's a lot of work done about it.
Yeah.
In India itself, so
But in a hospital like Pavlov, you know, they look like they don't look like human beings anymore. And the prime method of, I mean, they all know that they're going to go out in a gurney. You know, they're not. No one's coming to fetch them. It's an extraordinary kind of scenario of social abandonment. And in that context, you know, the electric shocks do not cure them. They are simply applied to, yeah, to punch them, or to sort of, in a way, render them non-sentient beings, if you will.
I think, quite to get a sense of why psychoanalysis has a vogue in India. Well, why isn't it seen as outdated, as something that's not state of the art?
Institutionally, it doesn't have a vogue in India. There are very few psychoanalysts in India. But psychoanalysis, as I said, you know, the traveling psychoanalysis, it is kind of, in a way, an umbrella term for a whole host of non-pharmacological psychotherapeutic techniques,
So it's a catchphrase for talking therapy, almost.
But most of the people who practice it have a degree in clinical psychology. A degree in clinical psychology in India involves reading all of Freud's oeuvre. So it's or they are sort of trained in psychiatry or psychoanalysis. So I don't think there is a vogue in it as such, except among the wealthy. But there is increasing need for it to, as I said, you know, addiction, which is one of the key problems that sends people to the biggest mental health hospitals. There's an increasing need for combining the psychiatric treatment of addiction with some element of psychotherapy that will help this person be rehabilitated. So it's seen as a useful tool for rehabilitation, if not the cure of kind of, you know, very serious problems like chronic addiction.
new topic, you said, you know, unconscious and non-conscious, and you were the word aversion.
What's that?
Aversions.
Yes.
I didn't get it.
Oh yes, so this is Freud said that the unconscious is like the aboriginal, so you know, the indigenous populations, and it sounds terribly sort of ethnographical and racist, but Freud actually meant that, you know, there are these residues of unconscious processes that we all carry. So I mean, it's my point was that, you know, I mean, Freud's point was in the quotes from Civilization and Discontents that I read out, is he felt that if you could treat individual malady when it was different enough from the context from which the individual, so you know, you're an unhappy housewife but you're surrounded by happy housewives, you know, so you're different and therefore I can treat you against the context of happy housewives where domesticity is not seen to be a huge failure, but if you are an unhappy housewife surrounded by unhappy housewives, then there is no psychoanalysis for you, because then that is your lot. So that's the kind of, in a way, that's how, what he felt about what you call primitive civilizations, that almost everyone's suffering from the same lack of a certain kind of civilization, so you cannot really treat them individually. And with the aboriginal population quote, that was, I mean, his example was racial, if not racist, though what he meant was not so much to say that aboriginals are terribly primitive people, but he simply meant that he carry these forms of mentation with us, even when we think we are not aboriginal, but modern. So, I mean, his interpretation of dreams is all about that, you know, about how we carry with us, you know, these other forms of mentation. You know, so a woman who's feeling that she's about to, say, cheat on her husband has a dream of falling, because, you know, somewhere in her head she knows that this idea of fall implies a loss of feminine virtue.
Maybe we can continue this over wine and cheese. Thank you so much.